Hello and welcome to Weekend Investing Daily Bites. Today is 21st of December. We're shooting episode 149. And we're going to talk about the lessons that we're drawing from the experience that people are having in Turkey, the way the currency has moved there, the way the inflation is moving there, how the stock markets are moving, and what lessons we can draw from there. Not necessarily are we saying that, you know, we may experience anything similar, but it is always good to experience what other countries are going through, just in case we may face some similar headwinds at some point in the future. First, look at the market. So after the drubbing yesterday, markets made a comeback, very strong intraday, almost 300 point Nifty gain. At one point of time, it seemed that the market is shrugging off the weakness and is going to create a bottom and start moving up here. But towards the latter part of the day, most of the gains in several sectors were given up, especially in PSU banks. And it does seem like there may be more room for a downward move in some sectors, especially. But the confidence of this entire move going up, downfall ending here, that did not come across at the end of the day. In terms of strong sectors, should I say stronger sectors, metals, commodities, real estate, IT, all performed quite well. But it was a bounce out of a major fall, so it'll have to be seen whether we can build upon these gains going forward. PSU banks, as I said, were the biggest disappointment today. Nifty closed about 1% higher based on this, and Bank Nifty was up about 0.5%. So Bank Nifty is still trailing. In terms of the weekend investing small cases, several of these small cases were running hot. MIATH2 was up 2.5%, NNF10 was up 2.7%, MI35 to 2.5%. Several of them did quite well, much ahead of the respective benchmarks. Small caps as an index were up by 1.2%, and mid and small cap index was also up by 1.28%. So overall, a good bounce day. Now the next question is whether this will sustain. Is it a dead cat bounce only? If banks are leading this fall, and so far it does seem like that, then the banks having given up all the gains today kind of suggests that this fall is not yet over and there may be more room to go. But again, that will be speculation and we'll have to see what happens. Coming back to the topic of the day, lessons from Turkey. So let me make the disclaimer that I am no economist, neither do I have any expertise in studying economic patterns. This is a layman's view and observation, and I'm trying to, share my views as I see them. So as you are probably aware, the Turkish currency lira has been in a major fall in the last month or so, and that is why it has been in so much in the news. But it has not been a new phenomena. Turkish lira has been falling dramatically since the last 4 or 5 years, and even before that, but in the last 5 years have been pretty dramatic, in the sense that the Turkish lira has gone from around 3-4 liras to a $1 to as much as 20 just this week to a dollar within a span of, five odd years. So it has been a gradual move since many years, and then there are bursts of, really a very strong depreciation of the currency. And the idea there, which the dictator there has been pursuing, has been that he wants lower interest rates because he feels that will propel the growth. And lower interest rates will propel the businesses, and they will be able to, export at better rates, However, his economics is not working because when you have inflation of 20%, 25%, lower interest rates fuel, the economy into hyperinflation. So basically, the usual concept is to keep interest rates low, boosting the growth and stimulating the economy. But that leads to some sort of inflation. Central banks then, increase the interest rates. This is actually incorrect. It should be increased. Central banks increase interest rates to keep inflation in check. And that's how the balance keeps moving on between, higher interest rates and lower interest rates, with the central banks sort of using that as a lever to propel growth or to, when the economy starts to run hot, inflation runs hot, the central banks use that monetary lever to increase the interest rates to cool down the economy. And then, the business cycle goes on like that. However, in the case of Turkey, the emphasis by the dictator there has been to keep interest rates low regardless of what happens. So economy was growing earlier and expanding, but inflation took over, sort of the reins of the economy, and inflation started running very hot. And two or three governors, central bank governors, he fired, who gave him the good advice to increase interest rates. However, he sort of overruled and kept interest rates low. And this is a chart of the inflation that we are seeing here. And although it was also very high earlier in the last 1 year, but in this last 8 to 12 months, it's really going out of control at about 20%. And you can see here that this is the interest rate chart that they did, massive interest rate cuts from 2019. It had reached almost 20%. And then they tried to increase it to control the inflation. However, the policy was remained more accommodative, and the result is there to be seen in the currency. So let's take a look at some charts that will give you a better picture. So this is the lira chart in the last decade, or slightly more than that, last 20 maybe 13 years. You can see, it's gone up 12x US dollar to lira. And although today or maybe since yesterday there has been a sharp rally back, this kind of a exponential curve usually it results in a lot of imbalances, and we'll see how. If let's compare this with USD INR for just to give a flavor of where we stand in terms of. So even USD INR over this last 12 or 13 or year period is up 80%. But look at the Turkish lira, it is up 935%. So it's in a totally different, exponential sort of regime. And just in since September, it has gone up just like a rocket upwards. So you can say, so what if the currency is falling like this? How does it matter? I've invested in the stock market, and this is the stock market index of Turkey. You can see that from 2009, in the last 12 years, it has gone up from 250 to about 2000, the index there. So about eight times is what the index has done in the last 12 years. So you may say that, I'm invested in the stock market. How do I care where the currency is going? I am making my gains here. But you need to also see what is the relative gain that you're making in dollar terms. So if I were to plot this in dollar terms, and divided by the US dollar lira, you can see this blue line is the stock market returns. And you can see that over a period of almost 12, 13 years, there are zero returns in the market. And mind you, Turkey is not a, it's a reasonably good economy, or at least it was. It has per capita of more than 3-4 times that of India, and reasonably good systems, infrastructure in place. So it is not that, you know, the economy was not doing well. It is just that the government and the dictatorship that they have chosen a path of self-destruction. So despite having, you know, good infrastructure, good facilities, good capacities in place, having good exports, a regime like that can destroy you. So the same can happen in any country. I mean, you vote somebody to power who may destroy you eventually. You need to basically protect yourself in some ways. And as we are seeing here, so this, I've also plotted the chart of gold in dollar terms against this. So basically, you can see that despite gold having almost a decade-long bear market, even that has done better than the stock market in dollar terms for the Turkish folks. And the bigger sort of chart could be, if I were to chart, let's say, gold in local currency. So let me say I want to do gold in local currency, and let me remove this. So you can see here that this is what gold has done for Turkish people, you know, in their local currency, going from 1200 to 22,000 in the same period. And if I were to compare this now with the local stock market index, so you can see here that over 12-13 year period, the stock market is up 700%, gold is up 2000%, right? So even if you go here, so there comes a point where the depreciating currency will start to hamper returns from the markets in a big way. The markets were, you know, down circuit on days when the currency was crashing. So you get hit both ways. Your currency is also crashing, and your absolute returns from that asset class are also crashing. So that's why the knowledge and the experience that, you know, you can be exposed to a environment where your own currency may become your biggest adversary, or your government may do things which may put you in this kind of a situation. You need to protect yourself. It's like trying to buy insurance. Maybe you may not need it in your lifetime, but you need insurance, right? So coming back to the presentation, let me just conclude here that, so there is importance to, you know, diversifying your portfolio. So if you were in a country where, you know, these kind of things were happening, and you had only local assets, whether it is stock market, whether it is real estate, whether it is all other, and very interestingly, when these falls were happening, people were even going and buying, you know, iPhones or other electronics, so that something may hold value. I even heard from a friend of mine who's a Turkish citizen. He says that the day we get the salary, we have to run to the bank to exchange it, either into dollars or into some other international currency, because the next day it is worthless. So that kind of panic and situation is there. So very, very important that we create non-rupee based diversifications in our portfolio, even if it is small, but that is essential. And I'm not saying this happens to the rupee or anything like that, but you never want to be, you know, totally exposed, as we can see that anything can happen at any point of time. You know, the regime may change. Who knows who will be what kind of government we may have in 10 years. So basically, this is something that you need to keep in mind and work towards it gradually. So importance of global exposure is definitely there. So dollar denominated assets, one could be looking at US stock markets, for instance. I mean, that is the most popular overseas markets that one is familiar with, or at least one is familiar with the stocks, technology stocks and large stocks that are available there. What that does is it diversifies your risk away from your local currency, at least to that extent. Whether that market will give you gains or losses, that's another level of understanding, but at least your exposure to the rupee will get curtailed to the extent that you have exposed yourself to the dollar, and it may give you that diversification. Beyond international stocks, you could look at having a exposure to gold. Now, gold, even if bought in Indian rupees, is priced in the dollar, right? So, even if, for instance, tomorrow the rupee may tank for XYZ reasons, the pricing of gold is an international price, and hence your pricing or your purchasing power remains intact even when your currency drops. And hence gold and international stocks become very, very important as a hedge to your INR based portfolio or assets. So this is the small learnings that I thought I should share with you. These are learnings for me, and I'm definitely working towards building more and more non-rupee based assets and diversifications, and I hope you will do the same. Thank you so much for watching, and goodbye.